today.
Are you tired of living with stained and worn out carpeting? Does the den look like bears spent the winter with you? Spring is here, and so is Empire Today's half off your project sale, starting now, but only for a limited time. Save 50% on a huge selection of carpet, hardwood, and laminate, standard padding and materials, and basic installation. Call the Empire Today half off your project sale hotline now.
1-855-385-0681.
Empire Today's free in-home estimates are easy and smart. Choose from high-quality flooring in the rooms where you'll use them, with your lighting, so you can see the color best. We'll do the measuring, you do the selecting and saving. But first, you must do the calling. Everyone loves the half-off your project sale. Even bears. Call the Empire Today special hotline.
1-855-385-0681. 1-855-385-0681.
Empire Today.
Select styles. Details at EmpireToday.com.
Blog Talk Radio.
Live. This is Under the Mat Radio with your host Tech, with co-host
NFC Game Boy, man.
Yes, and with our lead correspondent Shimblade.
Yes, I'm here.
Yes, welcome everybody. This special episode Under the Mat Radio. This title is called for this episode Wrestling and Oldies. Fans, do be aware. Yes, we do know originally. We were supposed to have Tony Todd, a.k.a. Candyman, to come onto the show today, but we had to reschedule. Tony Todd said he will be joining us in a special interview tomorrow night at 7 p.m. Eastern Time. So tomorrow will be Candyman episode, will be titled The Candyman Returns, with horror movie legend, acting legend Tony Todd will be joining us. For this episode, fans, it's called Wrestling and Oldies, because we have a couple of special guests coming up at the top of the hour at 8 p.m., we will have a great women's wrestler all around the world, multiple women's champion of many different promotions. Casey Carlo will be joining us. And also, we will have the owner of DK Oldies, Drew Stemmel, will be joining us. His company specializes in selling and vintage video games and breaking with a lot of vintage video game consoles. I know, of course, everybody knows that is the area which NFC Game Boy definitely thrives the most when it comes to that. But just to get all the logistics out the way, you can follow our show on Facebook at Under the Mat Radio. Please follow our Facebook like page. Please make the thumbs go from white to blue. Please follow us on our group page as well. We continue to keep growing and growing on that. Follow us on Twitter at @tech_UTMR. You can follow NFC Game Boy at
NFC Game Boy, spelled correctly.
Yes, and you can follow Shin Blade on Twitter at
Sensational One, SHINSATIONALONE.
Yes, and of course, if you need to email us with any ideas and any questions you may have about the show, you know, any business inquiries that you have, you can email us at underthematradio@gmail.com. Please do not forget to email. Please do not forget to contact us. Also on YouTube, check out our YouTube page, Under the Mats Radio, and also check out Shinblade's page as well on YouTube, which is Shinblade, where he has his shy blog, which used to be called Our Road Trips, where you get to see what we tend to do traveling to events before the show, after the show, and also in between during intermissions. But with that being said, of course, we have, as everyone knows nationally, want to make this announcement. Of course, everybody knows that we are from Baltimore. We still live in Baltimore, and everyone knows that we are in the midst of a lot of turmoil, a lot of distress, a lot of riots, and a lot of craziness that are going on. So please excuse us if at the moment we sound a little down, but it's very heartbreaking to know that our city is under martial law at the moment with having a curfew all over Baltimore City, as well as some areas of the counties with cops and everyone looking. With that being said, I'm going to turn over to NFC Game Boy. I'm going to have him speak briefly about the current situation. I'll speak briefly, too, on behalf of the show and on behalf of the company, and then we'll move on from that and talk about our other topics. Go ahead, NFC Game Boy.
Well, first of all, I want to say good evening to everybody who's listening, or if you're listening to a recording, of course, you know, us on YouTube. As Tech just said, that here in Baltimore is a lot of turmoil. Right now, currently, there's still riots going on in different parts, not as much as it was on Monday. Unfortunately, there are some people out there who taking this incident and using it as a platform for their own personal gain, and, you know, this is not how you honor a tragedy. Two wrongs don't make it right. And, of course, we know about police brutality. I've been a victim of police brutality myself. I've also been a victim of being in prison and breaking the law. And the tragedy that happened to Freddie Gray was sad. There are answers that needs to be said. I think that our mayor have not done the great job of really informing not only the people, but the nation, and letting them know what's going on out here. And, you know, it's really hurtful to see Baltimore in this place. And a lot of people have their opinions. You know, I know a lot of y'all are very spiritual. A lot of y'all are very religious. We appreciate the positive comments, some of these negative comments, racial slurs and stuff. We don't appreciate it. A lot of outside people have came and instigated and made this situation be completely, you know, out of hand. And it needs to stop. It really does. Peaceful protest Saturday just went downhill. We had a lot of people who done things. They said racial slurs to the protesters, which, of course, wasn't brought up in the media. And not even just blacks. It was whites on whites. It was calling them nigger lovers and, you know, saying that, you know, they shouldn't be here. And, you know, I now see that just because the media, you know, a lot of these outlets, they're showing us as a big place where no one really has any control, and it's not really like that, and it just hurts because the nation is watching Baltimore in such a negative light, and we all trying to get things together. We all have family members, we all have jobs that we can't make it to, you know. And it's just a time where we really need to come together. You know, this young man lost his life. There's still an investigation being done. And I can go on and on, but I'm going to leave it as this. To the people who want justice, to continue fighting for justice. But just remember that justice doesn't mean robbing and shooting and stabbing and hurting somebody else. You know, this is actions that's been boiled over from people being angry. And before you go say that, you know, these people, you know, need to not riot and not do this, well, also remember that a lot of these quote-unquote white people and other races, they just did a riot out in one of those universities. I think it was Colorado or Kentucky, one of them, just no more than a month or two ago. When they turned over cars, they burned up, destroyed property and everything. And though it was on the news, you know, we didn't hear a lot of information about that, but it was still a riot. So, you know, with emotions boiling, right now we don't need to have more fire, fuel to the fire. We need a lot of closure. We need a lot of answers. And I hope that everyone that's listening will understand that, you know, Baltimore is a dangerous place. But there's also a lot of love, a lot of great people here. I've been here for almost 35 years. I know a lot of wonderful people. And it's still going to be a wonderful place before and after this event. So that's all I wanted to say on it. If y'all have any other questions, feel free to contact Under the Mat. And, you know, you can contact myself. And I'll pass it along to you, Tech. Thank you.
Hey, with, thanks once again, boy. With that being said, we did want to let you know that please check out on our group page or and also our like page. Me and NSC Game Boy issued a statement video on behalf of Under the Mat Radio and also on behalf of Under the Mat Communications OC. We issued a statement not only to our fans and friends all around the world, but also to the city of Baltimore, which we live in, which we love, which is our city. So please check that out. Please make sure, if you can, everybody share it, tag people all around so it can spread the word. We made the video yesterday afternoon. Our video has been growing with views. People are commenting. Thank you to all those that are sharing it, that are spreading the word. We do know big ups to Ray Lewis, former Baltimore Raven. He did his video as well. I believe he did it. I'm not sure if it was last night or this morning. So we just want to use a positive influence and have a positive message towards this very negative time. Me, myself, I do have family that are cops. All cops are not evil. All cops are not vicious. All cops are not abusers of power. Yes, of course, there is negativity, and there's always the ones that abuse power with any job or any occupation. But do believe everybody in Baltimore, if you hear us talking, all of this rioting, breaking stores, setting cars on fire, trashing, raiding CVSs, senior center homes, churches, church buses, is not solving anything at all. It's not helping. You're making matters worse. While other people sit back and watch and laugh at this, it's making matters worse because you're affecting older people, you're affecting people around the world, even your families and friends that can't get that medicine, that can't get food to eat, you know, they can't get a decent place to sleep, they can't sleep at night. Also, it affects all of us here in the city because we have a curfew. So it affects everybody for their jobs. People can't work a full 8-hour shift, 9-hour shift, or work the 4 days of work because these have to come home early. Or if you work in retail, stores are free to open up because of fear of riots. So please, if you can hear us, all of those that live in Baltimore City, all around the state of Maryland, all the counties, please stop this rioting. Please bring peace, band together. There's other ways to have your voice heard. So with that being said, that's all I will say on the incident. Also, thank you to everyone in our wrestling family, personal family, all of the calls, texts, Facebook messages, Facebook comments, Facebook posts, tweets, emails, everybody that's contacted me, that's contacted NSC Game Boy, that's contacted Shin, everybody affiliated with us that asked for our safety personally and on a professional level. We want to say we thank you. We love you all. We are here safe, and we will get past this. We will get through this. But the more violence and the more things that are damaged, the more people are hurt, will make matters worse, too. Because after all the smoke clears, and after CNN and all of those stop covering, and after all of this stops, we still have to rebuild our city. So I would just ask that you please make it peaceful. Baltimore City is a wonderful place. I've been living here all my life. Going on 31 years, and if he ain't boy, going on 35. We know and love a lot of great people in this city. It is a great city. It definitely is. So, with that being said, I know Shinblade, I know you had a fan's comment. We can move on to other news so we can talk and give our fans and our listeners some sort of release to get their mind off of the tragedy just for a couple of hours.
I have to say I love both of your statements. It was really heartfelt. You know, fans of Tech NFC Game Boy have grown up in Baltimore City, Baltimore County, Baltimore, period, all their lives. Meanwhile, myself, I have not. I have been in Baltimore for about 6 years now, about just past 6 years, and I had to get off work early. Today, yesterday was a regular day, you know, these shutdown subway systems. I'm getting out, and right in my face when I get out is the barricade of cops and the riot right there causing mayhem, and I almost got caught up in it. I had to help a couple people get to safety because, number one, of the skin color, because he was almost being attacked. It is not fun to do this. I had, people checking in on me because I was raised in Virginia. Sorry. I just want to tell you that I'm okay. Much love. I put out a video myself. So I'm still here. If you can hear my voice, I'm here. But we got to do something. We got to do better. We can't have this going on. And I'm praying to God, I'm praying to everybody that hopefully we be safe and, well, this can stop soon. Tech.
Yes. It definitely does. Definitely does. So, shout out to you to, you know, families and all fans of Baltimore, definitely all around the world. But still getting texts, still getting emails and Facebook messages from people all around, fans of the show, workers, wrestlers, referees, promoters, agents, publicists all around that's been checking up on us all, and not only just us personally and professionally, just us as a city. So hopefully this time next week things will be a lot better. We'll be able to move on forward from this and be able to go on with our regular lives, and things will get better, definitely. With that, to get all the sad news out the way, we also want to send our condolences around the world of wrestling. Sadly, last night, the world of wrestling lost a wrestling legend. Wrestler name is Vern Gagne, a very legendary wrestler. He was the catalyst and the reason of a wrestling promotion that was called the American Wrestling Association, the AWA. He sadly passed away last night at the age of 89. Very great wrestler. If anybody that's not sure who Vern Gagne is, you could Google it. I know that. Shout out to all of our assistants and a lot of our fans have posted websites and web articles about Vern Gagne on the group page, so just check it out. He had his son, Greg Gagne, who was a part of the team, the High Flyers, with Jim Brunzell, who also wrestled too. So AWA was a great promotion back in the day back when it was all territories. The AWA used to air on ESPN. It was one of the first wrestling companies to air on cable television. Also, the AWA is known for the home place of Hulk Hogan, the Hulkster, before he became WWE, before Hulkamania and WWE and Brother and Say Your Prayers, Eat Your Vitamins. He wrestled in the AWA as well, and then he left the AWA to go to the WWF. So Vern Gagne, at age 89, passed away, lived a long, very long, legendary life. He passed away at his daughter's home in Minneapolis, Minnesota, and he suffered from Alzheimer's disease. So just want to send our prayers and thoughts to him. Shemblade and NFC Game Boy, your memories of Vern Gagne of the AWA, your thoughts of when you hear his name?
I'll just say a very, very classy dude. I was very shocked of his passing. I know he's in the Hall of Fame, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, I know the WWE was very saddened. And, of course, a lot of older fans who know of his work and everything, you know. thankful for the memories and some legendary great matches. Shin?
When I think about him, I think technical wrestling, because he was that guy. He was that guy who did Greco-Roman. And, yes, the AWA was the found, was the starting for Hulk Hogan and Hulkamania. He was, you know, like I say, he was a territory guy. He helped create a Ric Flair, superstar Billy Graham, and even Dusty Rhodes. A lot of people that don't know that AWA created stars. Even that's where the Iron Sheik came from. So it was very shocking to hear about it, and it's very unfortunate that on the same day that there's an uprising, there's a not an uprising, there's a riot going on in Baltimore City, and then this happened in the wrestling world as well. So to the Gagne family, we wish you well. There's another legend that's in the afterlife, and we give you condolences and everything. Tech?
Yes. Anybody get a chance, go on YouTube, Google AWA. Definitely look up Vern Gagne and his promotion. Very old school. Shout out to the Freebirds, too, who also worked in the AWA. A lot of the classic wrestlers from the 1980s or so went through the AWA. Back in those times, you could wrestle at multiple spots and with what they call territories to further your brand and your name. So shout out to Greg Gagne. You know, the passing of his dad, Greg Gagne is still alive. I know he's done some things for WWE as far as documentaries is concerned. So send our condolences to the family of Vern Gagne for that. And on to positive news. Definitely, I don't know if it's more positive. WWE just past the Saturday, WWE had their pay-per-view, if you call it that anymore, or monthly special called Extreme Rules, WWE Extreme Rules, which trying to figure out how do you have an extreme event when you're a PG company. Not really explaining that. You know, there were four kids, so it's Extreme Rules, but your audience, your target audience is all PG.
Mm-hmm.
But it's WWE. I guess they do what they want, right? They're on network and what have you. And it's
yeah.
Game Boy. I know you know. I'm sorry, go ahead, Sean.
No, I was about to say, yeah, whatever. I was going by your point, too.
Yeah, it's NFC Game Boy. I know you're good with words. Coming up with that one word to summarize Extreme Rules, what were your thoughts?
Actually, I didn't. I saw it, but I saw, I guess what you can say, a summary of it. Someone had a video, it was like a 5-6 minute clip of it. Of course, I was taking care of some business Sunday, and wasn't prepared for Monday. But, I'm really kind of glad I didn't see it all because it didn't look entertaining. WWE pay-per-views are really just not like that anymore. You know what I'm saying? You know, only thing I can really say that was good was the fact that, you know, I guess whoever tuned in got a chance to see the New Day when the tag champions. I heard the New Day's become heels now, which really doesn't bring a lot of joy to me. But, you know, I know Cena, he won, and I know Orton lost. Kane turned on Seth, and Seth still got a chance to win. I saw him do the RKO to Orton, which was pretty funny. It was, you know, the matches and stuff were okay, but like I said, from what I was seeing in the summary, just the pay-per-view was just lackluster. I think the disconnect with the fans and the product is becoming so evident. And with them trying their best to really work on solid storylines and stuff, I think is really kind of just, you can see how desperate the WWE is becoming. And even with the Tough Enough news and stuff, and shout out to all the Tough Enough people out there who submitted their videos and stuff on Raw. You know, one of our guys, BJ Walker, got a chance to be part of the snippets of videos and everything. You know,
hashtag snippets.
Congratulations to y'all. You know, but me personally, I would be more concerned with Ring of Honor and TNA and all those other adventures. You know, WWE really needs to do some soul searching. And I think they are really just so corporate now. You know, working for them will probably be good financially, but if you really want to be a wrestler, from the last couple of months of interviewing such some great stars, you know, Jim Ross, AJ Styles, and so many other people, I would think WWE is the way to go. You know, and looking at their pay-per-views and stuff, and even being at WrestleMania, it just don't feel like the way to go anymore. You know, it's just like, you know, you get the exposure if you want to be a superstar and everything, that's fine. But if you really love wrestling and everything, then, you know, it doesn't give you the platform anymore. And to me, Extreme Rules is another prime example of we're waiting for SummerSlam. Because these next couple pay-per-views is going to be just like the other ones. You know, a waste of time. So if you enjoyed it, then you enjoyed it. Me personally, I'm not going to give them 3 hours of my life for lackluster product. Because after SummerSlam is Survivor Series or Rumble and back to WrestleMania again. And even those are barely watchable. So that's my opinion on it. Back to you, Tech.
I will say, to go contrary to NFC Game Boy, which is very rare, WWE really isn't as desperate as they should be. Reason is because there's no legit number two company. So there's nobody really that's on the heels of WWE right now that's threatening when it comes to money and threatening with ratings. So sadly, because of that, WWE really isn't in any desperate. Us as fans know that they're desperate. Us as fans know that their product is a lackluster. But to Vince McMahon and those working with him, since they don't have anything right now that has to push them, so as a company coming in that has as much money as them, if not more, or that's crushing them in ratings, they're not going to do anything. And because of this, it's sad, it's because there's nobody out there to really push them that can really be a viable threat, so they're going to continue to produce subpar material. You understand what I mean? So, yes, to us,
yeah.
Realistically, yes, it is lackluster. It can be a lot better. But on a business standpoint, they're still fine. You still got all the eggs in the row, and they're still doing okay because they're still making millions of dollars, and they may not be making as much as they could, but they're still profiting well with the four kids and the pay-per-views. I will say with Extreme Rules, granted, it may not been the best pay-per-view, but we've seen worse Extreme Rules. We've seen worse WWE pay-per-views lately. Give it up to the fans. The fans did make the pay-per-view. The fans were very intrigued in it. Most of the matches weren't really as bad as I thought. The pay-per-view to me was a lot better than what I thought it was. Granted, was it the best? Could have been a lot better, of course. But by far, it wasn't the worst. I mean, there's it always could be go back to the Taboo Tuesday debacles or the WWE Great American Bash pay-per-views if you remember those. Yeah. but before Shin Blade go through each match one-on-one, overall, I will give my tech score give my diagnostic of the pay-per-view, as tech does, out of a rating of 1 through 5, I'll give it a 3.5. I'll give it a little past average pay-per-view. Shiny Blade. I'm sorry, I called you Shiny Blade.
Shiny
Blade.
Oh, Lord. Pause.
Yeah, I shouldn't be calling you Shiny Blade. It's somebody else.
Yeah. Actually, I started my own ratings as well, Tag. Here's the thing. I have 5 ratings, and I'm going to go from top to bottom. top is.
Did you say vibrating?
No, I said five ratings.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I heard you wrong. I apologize.
The top is watchable. Second from the top is barely watchable. Like, you know, you could be doing stuff. You could be doing, it's barely watchable. The middle part is meh, which means, like, you could be doing chores and still watching it, but you're not really into it. And it's bad, and then it's just flat out terrible. And I think for this pay-per-view, for me, was on the meh part. It was, like, it was late because NXT Game Boy and I was out, doing some business. So I watched it late, and it was one of those moments where, you know, it was like not and nearly napping, not to quote the Raven. So it was okay. I found one match very interesting, and I'll just go over it, like, when we go match for match. So I'm just going to keep my opinions to myself to the end.
Yes.
The pre-show, unfortunately, Daniel Bryan was not able to defend the title, so he switched the Intercontinental title out for a tag team title to put in the show. And this was just a one-on-one match, and it was Bad News Barrett versus Adrian Neville. Yes, I said Adrian. Neville won.
Shout out to Daniel Bryan. He couldn't participate because he's still having issues with concussions. So I want to give an honorable shout out to Daniel Bryan.
I thought that was his neck.
Well, last time I checked, it was concussion. It could still be stemming from his neck issues.
Okay.
But, real quick, with that, before you go on to match, and NFC Game Boy, what are your thoughts? And then after you, NFC Shin, what are your thoughts on Daniel Bryan as far as his future in wrestling?
Real quick, I just want to say I think Daniel Bryan's days are numbered. I think that he's really trying his best to come back for the fans. You know, he's a very passionate guy. You know, he's been in the business for a couple of years now, and really made a name for himself. Of course, you know, winning a big one, you know, last year. But unfortunately, with all of the damage he's done to himself, he's really putting a Band-Aid on a gash, per se. And I think that he really needs to take some serious time out, conditioning and everything back. I know, you know, we've seen him in the ring, he's done well, but I think he really needs a lot of time away, maybe even a year, you know. Remember, you know, when Shawn Michaels did it years ago, you know, Shawn Michaels was gone for almost, five, six years almost. Shawn was gone, and, you know, we all thought Shawn was gone forever, and then, you know, he came back, and he gave us another 5 years and everything, you know, on a full schedule. So, you know, I think that to be smart, you know, it's best to leave, and especially what I'm learning by me going to wrestling school and me actually in the ring and learning about conditioning and everything, you don't want to be that guy who really isn't 100%. Take the time out, get your body where it needs to be. If you can't get it, there's other things you can do. You can do commentating, you can do managing, you can do reffing, you can still be part of the business. I mean, of course, you know, wrestling is your love, but, you know, some people are lucky than others. And I just hope that, you know, he don't fit that category of one of those guys that have to retire too early or become even more hurt than what he already is. Back to y'all.
Wrestling school. I like the term wrestling academy better. Sounds more more legit. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
Okay.
We're going to wrestling school.
shout out. What did you learn?
Shout out to Riot City, which we know where it's located, but you won't find it on the GPS. It's kind of like that. It's kind of like the Bat Cave or other areas on Google, which, of course, I ran it up on a random news, that there are certain areas geographically that does exist in the world but cannot be found on Google Maps or any GPS. And we'll bring it to you for a random news segment. But, shout out to Riot City. We all will be attending wrestling school very soon. I know Shin Blade He went to his first wrestling school session. NXT Game Boy's been going for a bit. iTech will be attending very soon. So, of course, more things, of course, Under the Mat Radio expanding.
All right. Well, you know, about Daniel Bryan, NXT Game Boy had a point. His days are numbered if he doesn't take care of himself. Personally, for me, I think in WWE terms, he's going to be the Nigel McGuinness of wrestling. He's going to be the greatest that never really was, even though we do see him on television. And nowadays, I always cringe when I see his wrestling because when he does one of his combat maneuvers, he does a drop kick in the corner and he kind of rolls out with his neck and his upper back, which makes me cringe a little bit. Especially his flying knee finisher, you know, taking that bump in the ring is not padded well. I mean, it's padded well, but it's not like being on mattresses where you can get up. It's actual canvas. So, you know, Shawn Michaels came back after 4 years and then did eight years, as NXT Game Boy said. So, you know, there's two ways to retire in professional wrestling. You either retire on your own terms either walk out or you get carried out. And hopefully we get to see Daniel Bryan at least walk out, just like Edge and Shawn Michaels and among others. But getting back to the Extreme Rules card, Adrian Neville defeated Wade Barrett with the Red Arrow. I myself have not seen this match. When I heard about the Intercontinental title match being removed, I thought Wade Barrett was removed. But they let him earn a payday and have a match against Adrian Neville, who I'm really, really big in favor of. The only thing really is just lose to Kate. So. And get back to first name. Guys.
Okay. With that, we're going to go match and match with Extreme Rules.
Okay. First match on the card, which I really found interesting, was Dean Ambrose defeating Luke Harper in the Chicago Street Fight. This match was inconclusive by the time the segment ended, and they apparently jumped into a truck and sped off, and after, I think, the tag team championship match, they came back and resumed the match, and Dean Ambrose won with the Mick Foley DDT, as I would say. Your thoughts?
Anything, Game Boy?
I mean, I really didn't see the the pay-per-view, so I just saw the highlights of it, so I really can't give too much of a opinion of, you know, play-by-play, fellas. So I'm just going to leave y'all two to pretty much discuss this matter. And, you know, if you need me to fill in about the ending, I can tell you that because I've seen that part. But
okay.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I thought the match was pretty well. Went by pretty good with the first half. Seems how this is kind of like the beginning, the first half of the match was like part one. Part one of the match was really good. I loved the chair spot when Luke Harper suplexed Dean on the chair. Thought that was well. Loved the facial expressions and emotions from Luke Harper, looking like one of those crazy Deliverance type gator boys. Shout out to the movie Deliverance. Anybody need to watch it? It's with Burt Reynolds pre-mustache, before Burt Reynolds had the mustache. Clean shaven Burt Reynolds. Yeah, John Voight's in it. Who else was in that? A lot of legendary actors was in it.
I don't even want to think about that movie.
Yeah, got a pretty mouth, boy.
A lot of relaxing back, so.
Yeah, they had to relax that back, definitely, on that one. But, yeah, Luke Harper, loved the way he looks. And Burt Reynolds. Classic is in it. That's how Luke Harper looks. Definitely love the facial expressions. A lot of fans are wondering, why is Dean Ambrose's hair always wet? Same way with Roman Reigns. A lot of people have been asking us that. I have no idea. If we can get to the bottom of it, we will. But like I said, I love that facial expressions. They work well, great chemistry. Luke Harper is a very agile worker. For him to be the size that he is, being really tall and being big, he really can move pretty well in the ring. So I like when he used to wrestle. Hopefully WWE doesn't shove it down our throats where it'd be like Rock and Triple H 48, and you know, they wrestled forever and ever and ever in a day. You know, NXT Game Boy, remember those Rock and Triple H matches from like 98, mm-hmm. 99, 2000, 2001.
Oh, yeah.
They wrestled so much, you could see the Rock's hairline recede through each year. Rock. Match started, Rock had a full head of hair, then as it ended, he had none.
Wow.
Kimberly, your thoughts on part one?
I was into it. I thought it was great. And, you know, they got into the truck and sped off, which I found very, very interesting because I didn't know that you can actually do that. But that was, to me, the extreme definition of a street fight. You know, even though years ago, since you're referencing Attitude Era, 99, Hardcore Holly and Al Snow fought in the Mississippi River. Which I talked to Al Snow, like, when NXT Game Boy and I was at the UWE show, and he started laughing about that. So that was pretty much it, but I guess Dean Ambrose's hair is wet because of moisture and whatever in the arena, because, you know, hot lights in the wrestling ring. But honestly,
but when he comes
I was
out,
waiting
it's
for...
already wet.
Okay, I don't know. But the one thing I was waiting to hear from the Chicago crowd, because they're very rabid when it comes to wrestling, I was waiting for the Titty Master chants.
Oh, yeah, I love those. Shout out those. Yeah, there. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So the next match is an odd match for me. I don't really call it extreme. It's Dolph Ziggler defeating Sheamus in a Kiss Me Arse match. But, you know, as black people, even Americans, we say Kiss My Ass, which is a pause match to me.
If NXT Game Boy... would you mind quoting one of my favorite movie quotes by the great Al Pacino?
Oh, yes, most definitely. She got a big ass!
Exactly.
Really?
Great movie.
I love that.
Was that from Righteous Kill?
Casino.
I thought it was Casino.
Was it Casino?
It was Heat because
Hank Azaria was in the chair and he was like, I don't know what happened.
Yeah.
And he comes up, he's like, he got a big ass, great ass, you know, does that. So, yeah, your thoughts on the Kiss My Ass match?
Shout out to Sawtine, who's re-quoting what you said, Shin, talking about pause. You said about Dean Ambrose, the boy is moist, that's why he's wet.
Ew.
Man, you did say that, Shin.
Yeah, no. I said because of hair moisture. I didn't say boy is moist. That's nasty, man. That's disgusting. Saltine about to get his butt whipped for saying that.
Hashtag boy is moist.
No.
I'm sure it's about
no.
That.
No.
Yeah.
Side note, if you want to know who Saltine is, watch the last road trip video at 1CW.
Oh, yeah.
If you really want to know who Saltine is, because he had a pause moment with him in NXT Game Boy.
Yes.
So.
And NXT Game Boy's back wasn't relaxed.
So.
Please shake that out.
Yeah.
Yes, right. It was.
Kiss My Ass match.
Yeah, Sheamus' new look is creepy, but I guess, I mean, they had to do something different. I'm glad Sheamus is a heel. Sheamus and Ziggler also has good chemistry, so I look forward to them wrestling. So
that'd be wonderful.
NXT Game Boy.
Like I saw the ending of this match. Him, he didn't look like he kissed. It looked like he just like pretty much rubbed his face up and down. Luckily. You know, in any type of match, when you have to literally kiss the opponent's rear end, ass, arse, whatever, you already know that's a lose-lose situation. You know what I'm saying? It's just, and if you are the victor and you actually getting this person to kiss your ass, I mean, like, really? It's just, to me, it's just like just saying it is just it makes it even more redundant. But
question is, NFC Game Boy, would you do it?
No, not at all.
Yeah, we're not doing
that. I wouldn't want.
It's all over.
Well, I shouldn't, and I wouldn't expect anybody to kiss my ass. If you are, it's funny, but at the same time, it's kind of sad because, you know, they have matches like this. A kiss your ass match should not be at Extreme Rules. A kiss your ass match should be at a house show or something.
Yeah, it should be. It's Extreme Rules.
No.
That's not an extreme rule, though. That's
maybe, maybe if it was an, extreme, yeah. Maybe it was
extreme,
another body part
like,
or something else.
You know, we grew up in the extreme era, you know, in the 90s. Kiss your ass, man, really? Yeah, I mean,
look,
nah, that's...
Let me shout out to the other one, which was Val Venus versus The Rock.
Rock and Billy Gunn? Yeah.
Yeah, I'm sorry, Rock and Billy Gunn, I'm sorry.
Were you there?
Remember that.
Mhm.
Big woman.
See, who was that woman, by the way?
Oh, I don't know. It's a
yeah,
DLC,
and Billy
so
Gunn. Yeah, his face was all up in that.
Yeah, she basically sat on it. So.
Yeah, he did.
But anyway, you know, ass man to ass. So I guess it happened.
Yeah, he's a butt guy. All
right. Well,
shout out to him.
Yeah, literally. Monty Sopp, you know, shout out to him. Okay, all right. This is a pause moment. I did like the ending where Sheamus didn't do it and, you know, more of a heel moment. So, it was to me, I like that part. The next match, which was which I lost this match because I was going for the other team, the New Day, which in the combination of Big E and Kofi Kingston, defeated the Masters of the Universe, Tyson Kidd and Cesaro. Personally, I like the New Day's upcoming heel turn where they're doing it very, very slowly. It's not to the point where fans are liking it, but they're making it like of a Bo Dallas type thing where it's like I'm cheery, but I'm still a bad guy, which kind of creeps people out. But, you know, I'm a Hart family fan, and I like Cesaro, so I had to go for that team. And I could make a joke about this, about them winning, but, you know,
yeah,
I'll probably say it weeks later. Well, it's an insensitive joke. You know, it's not cool. Yeah, NFC Game Boy knows what it is.
I'm going to speak on this, and then I'll let NFC Game Boy finish. Fans, WWE Universe, which are different from wrestling fans. If shout out to Saltine T for posting that video. I'm not sure if it was Saltine or Afrocentric Queen that posted that WWE commercial where they said, we're not wrestling fans, you're WWE fans or something, had The Rock in it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure if y'all saw that. I think it was Saltine that posted it. But
I think so.
WWE Universe and wrestling fans, what have you, is this. And the IWC, Internet Wrestling Community. What really makes you happy? First of all, nothing pleases you all. First, when it was the first y'all cried, y'all wanted a black tag team. We gonna get black tag team. Black tag team. Ron Simmons and Butch Reed. Shut your mouth. Then you get the tag team New Day. You cry about that. You was crying about Kofi or Kofi, whatever you wanna call him. Called Kofi. Kofi got buried by Randy Orton. Kofi needed to change, and he did change. And now you still cry. Xavier Woods. TNA don't know how to use him. It's Constant Street. And then DD brought him in, and you cried about that. Yeah, credible Biggie Langston. Shout out to Heavy G calling him Big Empty. He was Big Empty. And then, Almay Johnson, Mark T. Changed it. Y'all still ain't happy with that. So then you bring them in together as the New Day. Church Gimmick was mad about that when they were faces. Now, they start to get booed. You're mad at that. Then it was, we need black champions. And now, they're the tag team champions. You're mad at that. So, at the end of the day, you realize nothing we can do and nothing anyone can do to make y'all happy.
Pretty much.
It was a good business decision. I'm glad New Day's tag champs. Shout out to Kidd and Cesaro because this makes them legitimate faces. Because since the Usos are going to be off the show for a while, they need a legitimate face. and Kid and Cesaro, they got a push. They got over because really WWE just threw them together because they had nothing else for them to do. But they're over. Kid and Cesaro could be over as faces. I love that tag team. And now you got the New Day as heels, and I think it was a good decision because what they're getting is similar to what The Rock got. Rocky Maivia was supposed to be a face. Fans traded on him, die Rocky, die. Rocky sucks. The Rock embraced that and became The Rock. And people end up slowly liking him, even though they booed him. Now, with the New Day, they brought the New Day in as faces. Crowd slowly started to turn on him and hate him. Now you give him the tag belts, which gives the fans even more reason to hate him. This makes you want to watch him even now because you don't like him in their tag team championships. It adds more attention to the tag belts, which looks like giant pennies. Also, good thing to bring back the Freebird rule. If anybody listening don't know what the Freebird rule is in wrestling, it started with the Fabulous Freebirds, legendary tag team. And it was Michael P.S. Hayes, Buddy Roberts, and Jimmy Garvin. When he was in the AWA and WCCW. Was it Jimmy Garvin, was it?
Terry Gordy, not Jimmy Garvin.
Terry Gordy, I'm sorry, yeah. Botch. Terry Gordy, Michael Hayes, Buddy Roberts, the original Freebirds in WCCW, AWA, all over. Freebird rule states when you win a tag team championship and you have three guys in your stable, any two of your three guys could defend the title. So it would go between, it could be Terry Gordy and Michael Hayes one night. It could be Terry Gordy and Buddy Roberts. It could be Buddy Roberts and Michael Hayes. So they're using that now with the New Day where it could be Kofi and Woods. It could be Woods and Big E. They can interchange it. And that's something I really do like. That's all I got to say with that. NXT Game Boy.
What about?
Well, I just want to say I have to agree with you. I think it's kind of good to have these guys having the belts. I'm not a big fan of the New Day, but I do like the fact that these guys are getting time. You know, they're getting the tag belts. So, and, you know, this kind of reminds me of the whole John Cena thing. You know, they hate John Cena so much, they just keep giving him the belt because the more they hate him, the more you have to watch it because he has the belt. So with them having the titles and making them legitimately heels, you know, you got to watch it because now you're trying to see who can knock them off and everything. So, you know, I think this will be a time that the primetime players are probably going to come into the play also as they were actually, you know, making references to them. So don't be surprised, you know, the primetime players is going to be creeping around. Next thing you know, trying to get their hands on the tag champs.
Well, I have to say with the New Day, personally, I don't think anybody liked them based on the vignettes that they had coming out. You know, the whole church thing. I mean, I asked who likes the New Day. The next you know, it was crickets. Except for one person that we all know.
You have a very strong passion for the New Day.
Well, I'm for black positivity, but this wasn't one of them, the way to go. And I say I'm positive on them now because of this impending heel turn and then the point that you got that I was going to say was the Freebird rule. You know, just like the Freebirds, just like Demolition, and just like a lot of other couple of other teams that used it. So. The only thing I find that I don't like is the Big E preaching voice, you know, because it sounds sacrilegious to say the least. But when the primetime players came up and did the promo against the New Day was talking about them, I mean, I found that a lot funny. So right now what we're going to have is primetime players come up, if not Cesaro and Kid against New Day, and it's going to be like black-on-black wrestling. And to tell you the truth, whoever's in the IWC realm of the Whiners division, please off yourselves because nothing makes you happy just like Tex says. I mean, you know what I mean? I try to find positivity into every aspect of what's negative, And right now with those section of the IWC, you'll never win. So the next match is the Russian chain match. Shout out to Nikita Koloff, because every time I hear that match type, I think about him. John Cena defeated Rusev. This match I did not pay attention to. I think it was just something to make Rusev look good, even though John Cena still won. And, you know, interesting point in this match that Lana was forced into the back to the backstage by Rusev because she acknowledged the Chicago crowd. So I don't know if we're going to see like a dissension between the two. But this match to me was not impressive like WrestleMania match that they had. Tech?
Cena won. Cena wins the end.
Okay.
I mean, did anybody really expect anything different? If anybody really thought, John Cena was going to lose the title, come on now. No. This is not happening. Especially with Daniel Bryan being hurt, they need a face. I mean, Seth Rollins is the face of he's the WWE champion. What's WWE World Heavyweight
Championship?
Title's teed on long. But
you said it right.
Seth is WWE champion. But John Cena, excuse me, fans, is still the face of the company. So like I've seen it, is the U.S. champion. Makes the championship relevant again. Makes the championship meaningful because Cena has it. I hate these, I can't stand his promos, but that's neither here or there. But he said Cena won. We knew it was going to happen. It's funny how Rusev was tearing through everybody for about a year. And yet, you know, he looks weak as hell against Cena. But, you know the storyline of Rocky IV, right? NFC Game Boy. It's a game, boy. Your thoughts?
The United States wins, always. And, you know, the belt belongs where it belongs. That is the biggest United States hero, patriot that we have, and that is John Cena, you know. Who else could beat, you know, who else could take him down? Who else could use that chain and wrap it around him and hit those four turnbuckles and light those lights? But, you know, the ferocious John Cena, you know, because John Cena, man, he can do whatever. I mean, he almost is up there with Chuck Norris almost. Like,
oh,
yeah, at least you're going to see John Cena facts.
Yeah, man, you know, like John Cena, you know, was almost like just a cult legend. It's like, you know, Chuck Norris. So, you know.
Shout out to the music behind us. The training montage of Rocky IV. We play it whenever we talk about Cena and Rusev.
Yeah.
We're just waiting for Cena to run up a snowy mountain and yell Rusev's name.
Okay. All right. Well, the next match, Tech, you
real
and
quick,
I can take this match.
I know in about
okay.
4 minutes we have Casey coming in, and you know how Casey is, the forever champion.
All right. Well, I'll let her take on the next match, and I'll go through the last two. The last two matches. Okay. The women's championship match. No, Divas championship match. Nikki Bella defeated Naomi. Pass for me. Your thoughts?
Crickets?
No, I'm just saying pass. Yeah, crickets.
Nikki Bella?
Yeah.
Yeah, Nikki Bella won.
Who really cares about the women's division?
Okay.
Well, I like Naomi. I just wish they can do more with her turning heel. You know, I wish they would do more in this match and with her, you know, give her a chance to have the belt, give her a chance to interact with the crowd and be a heel champion. You know, the same opportunity they gave with AJ, you know. Apparently, you know, she got pretty decent mic skills. You know, of course she can wrestle. You feel me? It's just I don't see what was the point of her turning heel, and she still lost to Nikki. I mean, it's just it, it just you know, it didn't make any sense. So.
Question is,
go
who really
that.
Cares about the mm-hmm, go ahead.
Going on that, it just the go on NXT Game Boy point, to me, Naomi turning heel is right parallel from 4 years ago when R-Truth turned heel. He turned heel, had a great heel segment. I think it was in England when he turned heel, and he was smoking a cigarette in the arena.
Right, which was great.
And he went to the next event. He went to the next event. Well, R-Truth was the event after. They went to the event, and they just lost. It was like build up and nothing. To John Cena and Nikki Bella, who is actually together. And to me, it just, it didn't do well for him. I mean, I can't say anymore.
Yeah. That's true. And they say, once Casey calls in, we'll give her thoughts on the women's division. Which
okay.
A lot of people really just doesn't really care about lately. Okay. It's not women. It's divas.
Yes. All right. Well, the next match is the last man standing match, which is Make Him Look Strong, Roman Reigns. He beat the Big Show. Dramatic as what he tried to put out. And I think this is less crickets than the Divas match. I fell asleep. I couldn't watch. I had to watch it more than once because I kept falling asleep during this match.
What are your cricket levels?
That was not nearly napping, but I actually started napping, so, you know, because I was watching it Monday night. So, your thoughts, Tuck? NXT Game Boy?
NXT Game Boy, your thoughts?
Well, I just want to say, once again, I've seen the ending. I actually liked the ending to this.
So, a lot of endings.
Because, yes, I saw nothing but the ending. I said that before we started this segment.
Yeah, you did.
But,
hashtag ending.
I actually liked the ending only because it made both of them look strong. I see that they're using Roman. They're trying to build Roman up as being, you know, like this underdog instead of him being beastly like he was before he went to WrestleMania. They're trying to build him up as an underdog. I don't know how good the match was. I'm pretty sure it wasn't that great. Probably was just flying Superman punches and chops and stuff, knowing them. But him flipping over the table and proving to the fans that, you know, hey, I had to lift this heavy table up and, you know, put it and slam it on top of him and hold it down on him for him to get up, you know, it was pretty cool, you know. But, you know, what? How many ways can you beat the Big Show? You know, I've seen him lose to the forklift. I think Cena did what he ate him through a bus one time, I think. Last
yeah.
Man standing, landed through a light. You know, how many times can you really, you know, be in a last man standing match with the Big Show and actually find a convincing way to beat him that we haven't seen before? So, you know, I know it's not, you know, genius what he did, but for his character to show that, you know, he couldn't just put him away and knock him out himself, he had to go to that extreme. I think it was cool for his character, you know, for them to keep him the underdog, keep building him up, you know. I'm starting to actually kind of sort of like Roman Reigns because they're not pushing him down our throats like they used to before WrestleMania. They're starting to make him be a little bit more like everybody else, you know, work your way up, so... fellas, back to you.
But you also remember that Big Show lost a match 2 years ago to Alberto El Patron when he was Del Rio by Ricardo Rodriguez tying his ankles around one of the ring posts so he couldn't get up.
Yeah, that's true. Well, with that being said, we got to bring in the woman of the time being right now. I normally say the man of the hour, but the woman of the hour, the forever champion, great female wrestler, women's wrestler all around, multiple champion of wrestling promotions all over the world. I believe she currently holds at least 6 to 7 titles. I could be wrong, it could be 8. And since I made a mistake, she's probably going to beat me up for it. Welcome them now, live to Under the Mat Radio, the great Casey Carlisle. Welcome to Under the Mat Radio.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be on Under the Mat Radio. And so far, not too many mistakes, Tech. Way to go.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you. Well, thank you
I
for
appreciate
coming
that
on
intro. Not too many mistakes. Notice I didn't say you were mistake free. I just said not too many.
Thank you. Let me say, NFC Game Boy.
Oh, it's always a pleasure to have this delightful flower on our show. Casey, how you doing tonight?
I am doing okay. How are you guys doing?
Recovering.
I'm good. Yeah.
Oh, did I hear a recovering in there?
Yes, recovering.
From what?
It's been a very emotional time here in Baltimore. So.
Yeah, oh, yeah. I can understand that, yeah. I can imagine how crazy it is actually being there versus, you know, seeing things on TV. It's a completely different beast.
Yeah, but we're getting our spirits back. But, Tech, I know you want to start it off.
Of course, with that, Casey Carlisle, we have you on. I know we started the trend with our interviews of you being the Forever Champion hashtag. And since you're a great women's wrestler, we were just stating how a lot of fans really don't care anymore about women's wrestling, preferably with WWE or air quote what they call divas. So I wanted to ask you first is what are your thoughts of the current divas division in WWE, if you do keep up with it, and your thoughts on women's wrestling as a whole today?
I think, you know, the current women's division on WWE, and I've said this in previous interviews, and it's because I truly believe this. I think a lot of the fans who have been wrestling fans for the past 10, 15 years or so, I think it's really hard for wrestling fans to let go of that golden era of the late 90s, early 2000s that was the WWE women's division at that time. When you hit Chris Stratus, Victoria, and and when Alexis Mickey James came in, you know, I think people got very used to having that period of time, and Jackie Moore was in there too, where you had women on your TV screen who could go in the ring and who really were, you know, some of the more quality women wrestlers that you were going to have put in front of you in that scope and in that arena and on that level. And I think a lot of fans have trouble kind of forgetting that period of time and not necessarily forgetting it. They should never forget it. But I think that it's hard to accept the fact that time has continued to roll on and that, you know, the wrestling business as a whole changes. It's completely fluid. It's always changing. It's very dynamic. Whether it be the style of wrestling, the look of the wrestlers, the way it's marketed, the target fan base, the programming itself, it's always changing. And that also means that one of those changes is going to be obviously the wrestlers that you see in the ring, but how they perform and what their style is and what their abilities are. And, you know, I think that those hardcore wrestling fans kind of sit here and long for the days of having those women I mentioned back in the ring. And I don't know if that means that they are so closed-minded to what they're being presented today that they don't want to give it a shot, or that they have given it that shot and they're just poo-pooing it because it's not the same. I think that we're starting to see the evidence of Sara Del Rey being down at the Performance Center and having an influence. Ladies that are coming up, I think anybody who watches NXT can certainly see the result of her work and her presence there. And I think that if they are a little soiled on what they see currently on TV as the product being presented to them, you know, if they kind of stick with it and they're patient and truly support women's wrestling. And when I say that, to me, supporting women's wrestling isn't just, you know, talking about it. It's saying the positive things about it. It's putting positive things out there. It's focusing on what the women do well or what they are, you know what, she's really good at, you know, conveying this emotion. Like, you know, when she gets hit, oh my gosh, like look how much pain she's in. Or, you know, those solid forearms. If people would just kind of present the uplifting points that they do enjoy, and it's a very negative world we live in, but I think that's one of the things that has to shift is, I think there is support for women's wrestling, but I think that it gets so buried under the negative because the negative is easier to focus on. If we can just reverse that and focus on the positive. And why do you like watching? Why are you a Kacy Carlisle fan? You know, why are you a fan of Bailey? Why are you a fan, you know, of Charlotte or whatever? Why are you an Emma fan? Why are you a Bella Twins fan? If you can just focus on the positive, I think that would really do good and help kind of bring new light into, you know what, yeah, I've never really stopped and looked at her that way or looked at her ability to do this well because I've been so busy focusing on what she does so crappy. I think it could really, mm-hmm. you know, kind of start having an effect.
Okay.
Women's wrestling in general, I think, is on an upswing. I think there's a lot of ladies who, you know, have put forth the time and the effort in their training that they should, that not every female does, to, you know, get a good foundation and start themselves off on the right foot. And I think people who watch indie wrestling can see the results of that because there's a lot of good, solid, quality women coming up through the ranks right now who, again, they just need to have that little bit of positive light and direction, shine on them and say, okay, yeah, look, there's all this crap over here, but let's look at what's not the steaming pile of the professional
right.
wrestling world. You know,
right.
and it's just a matter of perspective and what you choose to bring attention to or focus on.
All right. Thank you for that. Thank you. Kacy, do you mind taking a few callers from some fans?
Of course not.
Okay. We'll bring in Area Code 401. Welcome to Under the Mats Radio Live with Kacy Carlisle.
Hi, Kacy. I think you know who this is.
Oh my gosh. This is the one time I don't. I'm having a little trouble hearing you, so I'm not sure.
You are my Kacy, my only Kacy.
Oh, it's John. Okay. Hi, John.
Wow.
Hi, what is up? Yeah. My question for you is, like, were you ever wanting to take a chance for Tough Enough ever since the internet's been going on crazy, since the Indie Girls has been wanting to get on?
The internet has been blowing up with Tough Enough, hasn't it?
I know.
Yeah.
A little crazy. To be honest with you, I have zero plans of submitting a Tough Enough video or attempting to be part of Tough Enough, to be completely honest with you. That's not in my plans. It's not one of my immediate goals at this point, to be honest with you, John.
Oh, okay. No problem. Last question for you. Like, even though we're still short on the year, like, what do you think has been big so far that you'll see as the big one so far for your accomplishment?
My biggest accomplishment so far this year?
Yeah.
Oh, boy. I've had a few already that I'm kind of proud of, but, you know, I have to tell you, to be honest with you, I'm really proud of the last... the two title defenses I've had for Valkyrie so far this year. The first one was in January against Mistress Belmont in Woodbury Heights, New Jersey, and then the second one was in March against Bonesaw Jesse Brooks up in Staten Island. I'm very proud of both of those defenses because both of those matches, although very different in style, were extremely aggressive, hard-hitting matches against two women who very easily could have walked away with that title and who are top-notch in their own right. And I think if people, kind of hearkening back to the first question, I say this with not a drop of ego, but just because I'm proud of those matches, you know, if people want to see women go at it and just go out there and wrestle and just be aggressive and be wrestlers versus divas, I feel like those two matches accomplish that, and those are matches people should seek out and watch. I'm just very proud of those matches and you know, and how hard we worked in them and what we accomplished in them.
Right.
And
exactly.
I'm proud of the fact that I won
both of
them
again. See, I always keep up with you. Like I say, you are my Kacy, my only Kacy. You
Thank
make me
you,
happy
John.
When you're on the air because I enjoy when you talk about our teddy bear.
Well, thank you so much, John. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thanks, John.
Take care.
Thank you.
Take care, buddy.
Teddy bear. John's teddy bear. Hashtag,
Teddy Bear, I'll remember that.
Yeah,
Dusty Rhodes accent,
too. Yes, love the strong Rhode Island accent as well.
No, I said Dusty Rhodes.
Yeah, definitely it is. We're going to bring in our next caller, Area Code T40. Welcome to Under the Mat Radio with Kacy Carlisle.
My question for Kacy is, when you were a Rosebud, did you get to grapple with any of the wrestlers or any that are Rosebuds or put on a match in front of the agents with any of the Rosebuds?
I did, yeah. I had the opportunity to do so, and there were a couple of, you know, the agents scattered around. You never know who's watching you. That's the thing you have to remember. You have to pretend like everyone is always hidden and tucked away in that building watching you. But, yeah, I did have the opportunity to. And, you know, I will say I was a Rosebud twice. The first one was back in July of last year. The second time was in September. You know, my match, unfortunately, in July that we had, it didn't go so well. Just, you know, had a little unfortunate mishap and kind of squashed that. But then the second one, you know, went fairly well and was better, definitely. So, yeah, I had that opportunity, and it was a great opportunity that I was extremely thankful for. It's one that, you know, obviously everybody in the business should want to have given to them and should covet, and I had that opportunity, so I'm extremely thankful for it. It was a great experience.
Oh, all right. You got any more questions, Carla?
My final question is, what's the craziest prank someone's pulled on you in the wrestling business?
Pulled on you?
Damn it.
Oh, was that going to be a question? I have to say.
That was my question.
Well, then I'm answering you both. I hope, please, 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 that I'm not setting myself up here, but unless there's a joke that went really far over my head, I have never had a prank pulled on me exactly. I've been involved in some, and I've been privy to some that have been done to other people, but I have not yet had anything pulled on me unless it was really poorly done and I didn't even notice it. So knock on me, I'm literally knocking on wood right now because, you know, I don't want to have to be all mad at somebody and then, you know, candid camera moments, but I've never been in that position. I've been a witness and a very distant participant, but never the victim.
All right. Thanks much, man. Thanks much. Thanks much, Kiki, for calling in.
Thank you.
I have something for Casey.
Thank you. What's that?
Go ahead, Shane.
I have something for Casey. Since we were talking about ribs, has there ever been one, like a real funny one that you've seen happen, even though you did not participate in it?
The funniest rib that I ever witnessed that I will repeat on air is watching... Watching one of the guys, we had a double shot up near Pittsburgh one weekend years ago. This was back in 2007 or 8, maybe. You know, we were up there for the weekend. And so the first night, you know, we went out and having a good time, had some drinks. Well, this guy ended up having more drinks than, you know, anyone else. He ended up passing out, which is definitely a great big huge no-no. He passed out in his hotel room. And it did not take long for the decision to be made that he needed to wake up lacking eyebrows. So it was only a matter of minutes before somebody had pulled out a razor and then proceeded to shave off his eyebrows. They were going to leave it at one. But if I'm remembering correctly, they went ahead and did both. And he woke up with no eyebrows the next morning and then had to go work the show that night with no eyebrows. So that was, and I stood back and watched. I giggled, but I didn't ever, it wasn't me. It wasn't me. other than that, the only one I've really ever witnessed that, again, I feel like I can say on air is, you know, the good old classic putting, like, I think it was honey on somebody's car door handle. And all just smeared all over. So they went to get in their car. I think it was honey versus super glue. I really think it was honey, but, you know, which was harmless. And they were going to put the honey on the windshield wipers, and luckily I was standing there, or else it might have happened. So I was like, guys, that's a safety issue. If it starts raining and brother puts on his wipers, he is screwed. So let's just keep it to the ha-ha and put it on his car door handles instead of the windshield wipers. You know, that was a little less harmful and more of just being annoying than anything. But those are the two really that I am able to repeat and make public.
Okay.
Man. NFC Game Boy?
Well, my question for you is something that I know that I've talked to you about, you know, doing interviews and everything. But mm-hmm. I like to kind of elaborate. By you being a veteran in the ring and being very, very talented at what you do, has it
Thank
any
you.
Other performer female performer that have caught in your eye, that someone you would like to have a chance to get in the ring, or someone that's up and coming that really just, you know, flatters your heart or you might want to take under your wing? Any type of performer?
You know, I, for the longest time, I wanted the opportunity to wrestle Lufisto. She was actually wrestling, you know, before I was, and so I came up in the business being very well aware of who she was, and of course when I started wrestling, and I had an opportunity. I wrestled her at a Valkyrie event. It was Valkyrie, it was Valkyrie 2, I believe, last summer. You know, and I got that opportunity, and it was a great match. I hope that I have a rematch with her, because I'd love to work with her again. But coming up in the ranks right now, you know, I'm so horrible at coming up with names on the spot, but there are a lot of girls who are coming up. I've been wrestling Serafini a lot lately, and she and I had our first match together about a year ago, and she has really improved over the course of that year, I can tell, just being in the ring with her. You know, I can feel the difference in her. I can see the difference in her, both in her confidence as well as her work. I'm sitting here, you know, I'm really trying. There's really a lot, and I'm not trying to avoid the question and not give you a specific answer, but there's really a lot of girls coming up right now who are, you know, within their first couple of years, who I think, you know what, I think that we could have a fun little match with each other and kind of do some cool things. So I very much enjoy, I'm a teacher at heart, and I love being able to pass along any knowledge or any, you know, tips or anything like that that I've learned from others or that I've just figured out on my own over the years. So I actually, a lot of people cringe at working with girls or being paired with girls who, you know, although,
okay. Well, thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. Thanks for
the question. Thank you much for that. I want to ask you, too, because I know time is short. Yes, I know coming up, Casey, you're going to be going against Mickey James. Let us know about that match and your mindset. What will be your mindset to going against another wrestler that she's pretty legendary in the business?
Well, that match is taking place on May 16th for 1CW in Felton, Delaware, and I'm defending my 1CW women's title against her that night. My mindset going into it, you know, she will, not to disrespect the girls I've defended that title against, but obviously Mickey is going to be the top character to date that I'll be facing defending that title against. I'm preparing for it, you know, with you. I'm just making sure, you know, getting some more strength training in, getting, you know, making sure my cardio is what it needs to be, trying to plan out my strategy. I've had the benefit of being able, you know, obviously because she's had the exposure of being in WWE and TNA, I have by default been exposed to her style, been exposed to her her moveset, you know, and have an idea or a feel of what to expect from her. And so I'm kind of using that to my advantage by schooling myself on, okay, she might go for this, you know, just forming my strategy and kind of getting my game plan together. So, you know, just focused on being prepared, going in there mentally ready to step up to the plate on my side and on my behalf, because as you well know, I don't take losing very lightly, and it's Mickey James, and she's going to be a hell of a tough match, but I have to go in with the same mentality that I'm going to find a way to walk away victorious.
Oh, you got it.
All right. We thank you, Mitch, for that. Yes. NFC Game Boy, would you close it out with one last question? Because I know Casey is on a very tight schedule.
My last question to you.
We have 2 minutes. That's cool.
My last question to you is that what is something that you think the fans don't know about Casey Carlisle? What is a misconception that you think the fans haven't realized? I mean, you've been in the business for a very long time. You're very well respected and a great performer, a great worker. But what is it something that you've probably noticed that the fans just haven't really picked up on that you might want to address?
That's a really interesting question, actually. That might be the first time I've been asked that type of question, so congratulations. That doesn't happen very often.
Good job.
You know, if anything, I don't know if there's anything necessarily that fans haven't picked up on. One of the things, I will say this, and I to be honest, I don't know if this is going to be an answer to your question or if I'm just going to spat off its mouth, but one of the things I've noticed that fans say to me a lot is that they're so supportive of me and they think, you know, they give me compliments which truly humble me. And when I say I appreciate it, I mean it. But one thing people say to me a lot is that, you know, I hear a lot of, you know, like, you're going to break through, you know, you just need to, you know, if you just can wrestle for Shimmer, when are you going to be in Shimmer? When are you going to be in Shine and break through? And thinking, guys, what do you want me to break through? You know, I'm not sure. It's interesting to me that fans have a perception of if you work for these companies, you've made it to a certain level. If you don't, you haven't. And I'm not saying that in a negative or a bad way or an insulting way. I just find it really interesting that it's been carved into people's brains that if you're really good, you're going to work here. That, you know, it's just very interesting to me. You know, I currently, the only all-female promotion that I work for is Valkyrie. It's not Shimmer. It's not Shine. No, it's not WSU. It's Valkyrie. And I'm extremely proud of being the Valkyrie champion and my time with Valkyrie already because they are still an extremely young company. Extremely, you know, they're still finding their way. They're still finding their place in this world that has the Shimmers and the Shines. But I'm sitting here thinking, you know, it's just interesting to me to see people, you know, this, if you can just break through or you're going to make it, you know, or, you know, you're going to reach that rung. And I'm like, I'm kind of sitting on the ladder already, you know, kind of, I'm very proud of my accomplishments. I'm very proud of the titles that I have held and that I do hold. I'm very proud of my rankings in PWI over the years. I'm very proud of the fact that, you know, I am coming up, the end of July is going to be 10 years I've been wrestling. And I've been wrestling almost nonstop that whole entire 10-year. I haven't had gaps or breaks or time away from the ring for the most part. You know, and so I feel like it's just really interesting the perception that's out there when it comes to women's wrestling. But at the same time, you know, that's not to take away from those promotions either because they do have a lot of really great quality wrestlers. It's just interesting to me that it seems like fans have a perception when it comes to women's wrestling of kind of tearing it off, for lack of a better term. The only other thing I could say to try to answer your question more directly would be, you know, I think people would be really surprised to learn that, you know, I kind of am... I'm a little different away from the ring, you know. I'm very loud and boisterous when I'm wrestling, and I'm very mouthy. Everyone knows that, very obnoxious. And I think people are taken aback if they ever see me at an after party or something. I'm kind of not that loud all the time and not that obnoxious all the time. And I think it kind of takes people by surprise. Yeah. But that's the beauty that is Casey, I guess.
Hmm.
Well, thank you, Casey.
All right.
Thank you for answering.
Thank you,
Sarah. You're welcome. My pleasure.
If we want to ask you to, before we let you go, is what is your ultimate goal? And you've been wrestling going on 10 years, a decade of being very dominant in the world of women's wrestling. What is your ultimate goal that you want to accomplish?
My ultimate goal always has been landing a contract that would have me on TV regularly. When I was... You know, the kid growing up, I wanted to be a what was then WWF superstar more than anything. That's not to say I still don't. I do. Of course I do. You know, and that is a goal of mine. Or getting signed to TNA is a goal of mine. You know, I always want to do bigger and better. I want to have every opportunity presented to me because I'm going to take them as they come. No questions asked. I'm also a realist and a little realistic, and I know that they may not always happen. And so... my goal is to see, I kind of have this mentality of my goals aren't going to change. My ultimate goal is, yes, to be signed to WWE, to be signed to TNA, something along those lines that I decided when I was 8 was going to happen for me. But that being said, my smaller goals along the way, my more short-term goals are, okay, I'm walking the path to this one major goal I have. Let me see what other paths open up along the way, and I'm going to hop over onto those paths and see where they take me. And right now my goal is just to experience as many new opportunities as I can, to grasp as many new opportunities as I can. If that means it takes me out west, if that means it takes me into Canada, down to Mexico, if that means that I keep working for, you know, the exact same promotions I'm working for now, I just want to be able to truly see how far, what can I accomplish, how far can I go, you know, how many states can I wrestle in, how many different style of matches, you know, am I going to have a match under my belt by the time I retire, am I going to have a cage match, am I going to have a false count anywhere, you know, well, I kind of already did, but you know what I'm saying, like, I just want to see, like, what else is there out there for me to do? If I have a chance to do anything on that roadmap along the way to my destination, I'm going to do it. Because I'm just going to grab them as they come. I could get hurt in my next match, knock on wood again, and be done. So I just want to seize every opportunity presented to me while I have the chance to.
All right. Thank you for that. Thank you for that answer very much. Definitely want to give you opportunity first. Thank you much for calling in. I know you're a very busy woman. You're the five-a champion. You got to defend all 7, 8 those belts around the world and keep up
it's
with your personal
five.
Life.
That was the one little thing you were wrong about. It's 5 right now.
Still 5, 4 more than Cena. You got 5.
That's true. I like 6 or 7 better, P.S., but it's 5.
Yeah. So,
but
well,
this
we
time
much
flew by, guys. We're going to have to do this again.
Oh, we will. Very
yeah.
Soon. We definitely will. We definitely will. Real quick, go ahead, do your plug party, as we call it, plug and promote anything that your next appearances and whatnot.
Well, I will say my next appearance is this coming Saturday, which is May 2nd in Kannapolis, North Carolina, for OSCW. I'll be taking on Misty James. And then the following week, Friday, May the 8th, I'll be in Petersburg, West Virginia for Elite Pro, defending my Elite Pro title against Tess Valentine. The next night, I'll be in Mill Creek, West Virginia for Pro Wrestling Mid-Atlantic, once again wrestling Tess Valentine, regardless of what happens the night before. I get to beat her up twice in one weekend. I'm thrilled. You know, above and beyond that, my website is kaycecarlisle.com. I keep it updated just as much as I possibly can with my upcoming appearance schedule, photos, videos, et cetera. Basically, what I'm saying these days to condense everything is if you go on Google and search my name, you're going to find me. I'm on Twitter, Instagram, YouTube, Facebook, and I have a Facebook fan page, all under Kacee Carlisle. So if people just search that, they're usually I'm not usually that hard to find.
No.
Well, thank you much, Kacee, for that time. We will have you back on very soon, and we're going to have you on for a longer time so we can talk more about your career and other things, and maybe even more ribs and Johnny might call in and talk about his teddy bear, and who knows who may call in next.
All about it. Well, I'm up for everything. We'll do an hour-long segment or something next time so we can just chat away.
Yes, we will. All right, Kacee,
thank you so much for the time and having me on. You guys have a great evening.
You do the same, baby. Take care of yourself.
Thanks, guys. See you guys soon.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Everybody that was the Forever Champion, currently holder of 5, got it right, 5 women's championships all around the world. It's the great Kacee Carlisle. Thank you much, Kacee, for coming on today. That being said, we're going to bring in our next guest right now, live. This man is the owner of DK Odies. This company is very good. Good old buddy, Saltine, thank you much for hooking this up. He's purchased a lot of games and whatnot from this company, specializing in a lot of vintage or old-school video games, and it's a Game Boy, of course, is the resident professional gamer. The man himself, the owner, is now alive. His name is Drew Stimmel. Hopefully I got the last name right. Welcome you now live to Under the Mat Radio.
Hey, guys, what's up?
Hey, what's going on, man?
Hey, how's it going, man?
Hey, not much. This is quite an operation you guys got. It's pretty cool. I was listening to Casey right before I came on. It was pretty cool.
Hey, thanks. Yeah. Did we get your last name right?
No, it's Steimel, but that's all right.
Steimel. Okay. Steimel,
yeah.
There you go. Yeah. Thank you much for being on the show. Of course, Under the Mat Radio, we cover everything from wrestling to pop culture, mixed martial arts and whatnot, comic books, and, of course, video games. Just to let you know, recently we just had the great AJ Styles on our show, current IWGP champion. He talked about video games for about the first 40 minutes of the interview. Kenny Omega, current great wrestler in Japan, he talked about video games. A lot of wrestlers around the world and even comedians love video games very much so.
Yeah.
And, Drew, I'm going to turn it over to NFC Game Boy because he's a professional gamer. And we're going to have to start things off.
You got Game Boy in your name?
Yes, my name is NFC Game Boy.
That's awesome.
Thank you. I've been playing video games since 1987. And
how old are you?
I'll be 34 this year.
Oh, yeah, you're prime age.
Yeah. I have been professional since 2001.
What does that mean, professional?
When you become a professional gamer, it's when you start winning video game tournaments. You start being pretty much categorized.
You start making money playing games.
Yeah, you make money. I've been to, like, ECC's Coast Championship. I've been to EVO, which is the World Video Game Championship. That's every year.
That's great.
I played in other several video game tournaments throughout my career. I'm not really playing like I used to. Of course, I'm gotten older. So,
you're past your prime. You're 34 now. Your reactions aren't even close to what the young kids right?
I can I still play my Tekken. I was once considered one of the top five in the East Coast in Tekken back in like 2000. Yeah, I'm still really good, and I play Tekken on PlayStation, and I still get my girlfriends, they be watching me. I get messages from people who be like, wow, like, you're so good. And, you know, they like, I've never seen somebody do some of the combos and stuff that you do. And I'm laughing because I'm like, I'm old, you know. But when you hear my name, it sounds like a kid. So a lot of times, you know, I get good ones and I get bad ones, too. And they're like, you know, you're just a kid and all that. And I'm like, I'm probably old enough to be this guy, this kid's father. But anyway, my question to you is, with your store, what is the one thing that really drives you to want to start this type of business?
I would say I started about like 10 years ago, and maybe a little longer than that, but it was right when eBay was starting, early 2000s. And, you know, I was a young 20-year-old kid, didn't go to college, didn't really do anything, nothing in front of me. And I was like, oh, man, I like Double Dragon. I'm going to buy that on eBay. So I bought it, and I got it. And then I started looking on eBay, and I'm like, oh, man, I could buy these games and then resell them right back on eBay and make money. So I started doing it. I used to play poker, and I took all my poker money, and I stopped playing poker, and I just started selling video games. And it just started growing from there. I had a little office up in my apartment upstairs. I just had my bedroom, and I just started selling video games out of there. And next thing you know, I got to hire another person to start shipping. And it just sort of grew. And then I would say in like 2006, 2007, eBay started to change, and the internet started to really change. It didn't really happen that long ago. People forget. But like Google really wasn't around when I started. It was there, but it really wasn't a big player. And then all of a sudden, Google started competing with where the normal person could have a website and a store and advertise it right on the internet. And eBay started taking a lot of heat from Google. And so we saw the writing on the wall real early. We left eBay. And I was still working out of my house at that time. And, you know, we just did DKOldies.com and left eBay and just started from there. And then I started, you know, I had some kids. They started getting older and they're, you know, they're coming down the basement all the time while we're shipping. And I got, like, guys here working. I'm like, hey, we got to get out of the house. My wife's going to kill us. So we got an office. And it just took off even more from there. And, I mean, I started first few years, we would do like the first year I remember doing like $10,000 in a month. And I thought I was the richest person in the world. And now, you know, we're selling like millions of dollars worth of video games every year. And it's crazy. It's just mind boggling how it happens.
Wow. Wow. Thank you much for that. When I ask you, you play video games.
Yeah.
What is the toughest video game to date that you played?
Well, there's some tough video games. But, like, if you go back in the day, like, today they make tough video games. But, you know, you get your strategy guides and you can work them out. Like, back then, they made video games and I guess they made them, like, there wasn't as much money going around as there is today. So, like, today they'll make a perfect video game, and everything is flawless in the game. Back then, there were just errors in the game, and you couldn't get through it. Like, there's a game, like, I don't know if you guys know, like, the old NES games, like Battletoads. Like Ninja Gaiden and stuff like that. Like, everybody's played them, but you always play the first level or so. Because if you get to, like, the third and fourth level of those games, they're so hard that they're basically unbeatable. And, you know, some people say they've beat them, and I'm sure that they have. I'm sure you can go on YouTube and see some run-throughs and stuff like that. But to the average person, they are so crazy hard because I think there's, like, glitches in the game where they make them so you can't even play them. And I would say Battletoads is probably the hardest. I would say as far as, like, the most popular, hardest game would be Ninja Gaiden.
Oh, my goodness.
Part one? The original part one? Or
the original Ninja Gaiden, yeah.
The original, okay.
That is pretty hard.
That game.
But,
that game is crazy hard.
Let me state for the record, I actually beat Battletoads. With no Game Genie, it took me 6 hours.
Like, the racing part was the hardest, right? It was like
the one where
you had to, like, race.
That's the third board
like
in the cage,
jet
in the cavern.
That was just insane.
There's a time warp on that board, and that time warp sends you, like, three boards, and when I kept playing it, I was playing video games when video games was clownish, when it was nerdish. See, now, if you don't play video games, people look at you like, what are you doing?
Funny.
But back in the 80s, when you played video games, you know, girls didn't like you, guys was like, oh, you're a nerd and all that. And that was my forte. I was the first guy to beat Battletoads. I was the first guy to beat Mike Tyson Punch-Out. I was the first guy to beat the original Ninja Turtles. It was like, the original
Real
Ninja
quick,
Turtles.
The original Mike Tyson Punch-Out, not the
yes,
Punch-Out
the
after Mike Tyson.
In the arcade. The original was in the arcade. Do you remember that one?
Yeah, I remember that one. But, with the little, I remember the two handles, and you had to get them. It was crazy because the guy was like green with lines in him.
Yeah,
and,
you could see through him.
Through him.
It was very,
and they had that big bear hugger guy, like he's like this bear.
I was a little kid and I'd walk into the arcade and I was only like as tall as the controller, and it was filled with like teenagers back then, so you're already intimidated. And I would lose. Mm-hmm. Bald Bull would just beat me, and then they laugh at you right in the arcade.
Yeah, they laugh you right on out. And
I hated Bald Bull.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Shinblade.
Oh, go ahead. I'm sorry. Go ahead, Jack.
Shinblade.
Yes. I'm listening.
Yes. Video game memories. We got Drew on, the man himself, the owner of DK Oldies. Talk about your memories of video games, Shin.
For me, I had a cousin that got me on to the first Nintendo with Super Mario Brothers. And after that, that just told the future. You know, I played games, Super Nintendo. I was on the Nintendo realm when it came to games, and I moved over to Sony. And one of my favorite games in SNES, which I'm trying to find, which I haven't looked on Amazon yet, it was called Saturday Night Slam Masters. It was my favorite game throughout middle school. And actually,
game was great.
I first moved into the States when Slam Masters came out from Hawaii. So when that game came out, it just kept me in the house like all winter. It was like 12 characters, but it was monotonous, but it was just playing the game made it fun. It was just like the replay value for me was very, very high. And the only thing that upset me was they had a part two, and the Genesis version was very, very different. But when I saw the video game play on YouTube, I hated it because you didn't beat your opponent by pinning them. It was like Street Fighter where you beat your opponent by knocking them out. It was like Street Fighter, and I didn't like that.
So, but, have you played a lot of the wrestling games? Because I heard a lot of people. That's like up there in like the top 10.
That's my argument. That's my argument. The wrestling games.
That is for me number one as far as generic wrestling games. But the second one to me was WWF WrestleFest.
Why gotta be generic?
Well, because it's not licensed. It's not licensed like wrestlers or anything like that. The second one is WWF WrestleFest, and then the next one is I forget what it is, but I had a PlayStation 2, and to me it's hard with the controls. Is the Japanese wrestling game that Tech and I know about?
Did you guys ever play the Nintendo 64?
Oh yeah.
So like what most people consider the greatest game of all time for wrestling would be No Mercy. Have you guys ever played that?
Oh yeah,
it's got The Rock on the cover of it.
Yeah,
I pre-ordered it.
Diggity dog, that weird background music. Remember that?
Diggity dog,
diggity dog.
Come out like that. But to say the truth, with those games, we all liked it. We all had parties that night in Virginia where I grew up.
Yeah.
So I
remember
back
when kids used to like hang around each other, right?
They used to go outside.
They used to have to play video games together.
Yeah. Right. I remember I pre-ordered it when I was in high school. By the time I was calling between periods, so when they had the game available around about 11 o'clock, I'd get in my car and go all the way down to Military Circle Mall and get the game and come back and keep it in my trunk, so I would rush home after high school to play it, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. I never really played Saturday Night Slam Masters too long. I think I might have tested it, but I never really played it. But I played WWF Raw for Super Nintendo. That was probably my favorite.
With
the hidden moves. That had so many different characters. It's more of a arcade-y type, you know. I think more of the simulator would be like No Mercy and like the newer games too, but I always liked Raw. I would always go over to my friend's house and he would play as Mr. Perfect, and he would perfect-plex me, and he would like get up and like do the move. It was crazy.
That was back in the day when you put somebody in a submission hold and then pin them.
Yeah.
Put somebody in a sharpshooter, hit a little meter, and then you used to hate the out to the cheaters out there that used to have. Because I had it on the Genesis, and my buddies had it on the Super Nintendo. But shout out to those who cheated on the Genesis that had that darn turbo button, turned it on high so they could cheat. Because, you never could win. Someone had the turbo button on high, when the darn meter, you used to always win the grapples all the time. So shout out to Tony Pyro, who cheated all the time. Yeah, call me, you out in California. And Lil James and all of them, they cheated with the six-button Genesis controllers.
Oh, my God, calling them right out.
Oh, yes.
Put on
the
tech
blast. I love it.
Hashtag
we might have that game, that Saturday Night Slam Masters. We might have it. We bought a big collection. Came in today. We got 1,500 NES and Super Nintendo games. We took pictures, put them on Facebook. We just haven't gone through them yet. But I mean, I'm sure that game's in there. So it'll probably be on sale this week.
Well, once the curfew goes down, I'll be on my way.
There you go.
Yeah. Yeah, we're on curfew. We'll have to make a trip, Under the Mat Radio trip, to DK Oldies and come over there and do some business, definitely.
We just started doing a podcast, actually.
Like
a video, not a radio podcast, but a video podcast. It's a lot of work. I'm impressed with you guys.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah,
thank you for that.
Yeah, we've been doing it for like I think it's our fifth week, and yeah, it's a lot of prep. I feel like we were just gonna wing it, and then every week you gotta like prep what you're gonna talk about, who you're gonna do. You guys have guests, so it kind of makes it a little easier, I think. We're gonna have to start getting guests. I'll have to get you guys on there.
NFC Game Boy, we for that.
Yes, actually, I am a video game collector. I've been a video game collector for, I think since 93, 92. And my video game collection, the last time I assessed it, I think that was 2010, is roughly about $35,000.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Hmm.
I think last time I looked, it was like 35 to 40 grand. That's how much money
you have them all set up in your house, all nice.
Yeah, I have them in what I call my vault. And
there you go.
We had AJ Styles
like
on the show.
Huh? Kind of like that 40-year-old virgin setup with the action figure.
I have them in my vault. We had AJ Styles on the show like a month ago, who I found out also was a gamer, which I didn't know. We was trading game stuff on the show. And he was looking for a Virtual Boy, and I actually had a few Virtual Boys, and I had one already in the box. So what I did was we made a trade, and tomorrow, actually, I'm going to finally go out and ship the Virtual Boy to AJ Styles so he can have his official Virtual Boy system, because he said he's been looking for it. I told him it's very unimpressive. Yeah, I told him your eyes is going to hurt. It's very unimpressive, and it's awesome
to just see it, just to have that thing. It's a piece of history.
Yeah.
Now,
not all history.
Wow.
Good. I mean, in our realm, it is, but. Yes, that's.
I like to look at it like all like Nintendo was so big back then that they were just trying all kinds of crazy things. Like no company back then was doing like what they were doing. They're making video games, and then all of a sudden they're just like, oh, we're just gonna make a robot. put out a robot. we're gonna make 3D stuff. We don't know what we're doing. It doesn't matter.
Yeah, I have my ROB robot still in the box. In the box that came with it. My ROB robot that came with Gyromite, which a lot of people, if you really know about your Nintendo systems, Super Mario Brothers came much, much later. The original Nintendos came with a robot that actually you had to play against. And it was a game called Gyromite, which was the
game.
Right.
Well, that came out later. The first Nintendo came out with Mario Brothers.
That was regular Mario Bros.
Nintendo NES, the first Nintendo, it was bundled with Super Mario Brothers and Duck Hunt. And then later, like much later, they came out with the robot and stuff. You can check.
Hmm.
Okay. I've been corrected.
It was they came out with the robot, and then what happened was the robot didn't really do so well. So it didn't sell like they wanted it to, and they stopped making games for it. And then the Genesis, Sega, was like, there's a chance we can get in the market here. So basically the failure of the robot was how Genesis got into the video game world.
You mean the Master System?
The Genesis was like, the Master System was there, but it really didn't compete. And then when the Genesis came out, they like really took it head on to Nintendo.
Oh, we got to sit down and talk. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, we. Well,
and we would do that. When Under the Mat Radio, after this curfew, actually, it ain't got to be at night. Could be sometime soon. Under the Mat Radio, we could talk off air, and we could definitely set up a meet time maybe this week or next week and give a video game history talk, do some business, maybe some trades.
Mm-hmm.
We'll make sure we get your last name right, T. Drew.
No problem.
Shimbley, you're not talking much about video games. When I ask this question real quick, is a roundtable, is a start with you, Drew, because I know we showed on time. most frustrating video game to play?
Oh, man.
You
know what, I'm gonna say something, but it's probably not the most popular, but probably like any kind of platformer game for me, any kind of game where you have to jump, and if you don't make the jump, you're gonna die. So even like Mario 3, a game like that, or Mario World, like they're frustrating for me. I can't play them.
Hmm. And it's a Game Boy. I know you're the professional. He gonna come up with some like real complex answer.
Actually, the most frustrating game that I can think of currently, right now in my arsenal, is Tekken Revolution for PlayStation 3, because they got all those power-ups and stats and stuff. I can't stand that mess. But if you want to say overall back in the day, I'm going to have to give it to either between Battletoads and Metroid. Because
Metroid.
If you die on Battletoads, unless you've gotten really, really far, that's when you can actually earn continues. And in Metroid, when you die, they only give you about 10 seconds to write down your password. And then after that, that's it. So it's like, unless you have your paper and pad ready, or your pen die on you, or your pencil break on you, if you write down your password wrong and stuff, you pretty much got to do it all over again.
Shout out to a fan that said, Shimbley, I heard that your toughest video game to beat was Burger Time for the NES.
I never played that game, honestly. And for the fan who would taunt me and say that, I dare you to get on the show or else off yourself. But really,
dude, what is off yourself? What is that? What is off yourself?
Well, in this time, I want to say kill yourself, but it's not a good thing to say. So it's just like, you know, it's kind of like go kick rocks or something, you know. I'm just trying to stay positive with the conversation. No, my toughest video game, Metroid was one of them, like NFC Game Boy said, because I couldn't write that fast when I was a kid. One of my toughest, I could say right now, is the Batman series when you play on super hard, because it's like the combinations that they have with the combos. I'm just all about kicking people's behind. So it's like certain combinations you got to do, and they say you got to do it this second. It's like I can't because I'm so fixated in defeating people.
Okay.
And for me, my most frustrating video game of all time, and this answer is going to be very random, as I am as tech, and I played more frustrating video games. I'm not a pro like NFC Game Boy, but I played tons of video games too. As a adolescent, I hated Altered Beast for the Sega Genesis. That game irked my soul.
That's a great game.
Rise from your grave. Power up. NFC Game Boy, though.
25
to that game. I know. I beat the game. I beat the game, which is that voice and that music and I hate it. That game was the most frustrating game in history. It wasn't so much the difficulty level, it was just the specs, the music, that voice, rise from your, you know, welcome to your doom.
Oh, my God. So what's next for you? What
was that? What was that, Shane?
What's next for you that's harder than that? E-SWAT?
Super Mario 2 was really tough for me as a youngster, as his old folks say. As a youngster, Super Mario 2 was tough. Yeah, for some reason, Super Mario 3 was easier for me to beat than Super Mario 2. And then I realized it really wasn't supposed to be Super Mario game.
You know, I noticed that. A lot of people had problems with Mario 2.
It was even a real Mario game.
I know.
It was different.
Yeah. They didn't want to bring out Mario 2 because they thought Americans wasn't good enough. They thought that we couldn't be negative, so they made another one. They bought the right with this other game and made it Mario 2.
Yeah. Mario 2, what they actually did, Mario was so successful that Nintendo was like, we need a Mario game now. And so they just ported over a Japanese game and put Mario guys on it because they didn't have time for Mario 3. It was in development.
But
did y'all read an article about Mario 4? There's actually a Super Mario 4 that they finally started releasing.
Fans,
I haven't heard about that.
We got 90 seconds real quick. time has went by real quick. Drew, we have your permission. We can contact you right after the show. But 90 seconds left. We got to go. We thank everybody for calling in. Thank you, Casey Carlisle, and the five-time women's champion that she is. We thank everybody for calling in. Thank you much. Don't forget, tomorrow we will have legendary actor, horror movie legend, Tony Todd, otherwise known as Candyman. Candyman will be with us on tomorrow, 7 p.m. Eastern Time, under the Mat Radio. Thank you much to John Nicodin with the Johnny Teddy Bear Stories. Shout out to Saltine and Shimbley and his boy being moist. Everything else. Thank you, Drew, for calling. DK Oldies.
Yeah.
We'll see you next week. Talk to you
later,
right, Drew.
All right. See you.
We'll talk
later.
Love y'all.
Hashtag
Baltimore
much. Uprising.
Yes, hashtag Baltimore Uprising. Hashtag Pray for Baltimore. Hashtag Freddie Gray. Sorry, so it's me left. Shane, we got him off a couple of hashtags.
Baltimore Uprising, Johnny Bear, Peace, hashtag Sensational, hashtag Tech Blast, NFC Moment. I guess that's it. Hashtag Saltine Moist Boy.
Right.